We good?
Yes.
We have welcome you to Christ the King Wilmington. Those of you watching on Facebook Live, our production staff is limited, so we won't have any overheads. We're going to sing Old Fashioned with a song sheet in a minute. But I just want to begin with prayer, and then we're going to sing Great Is Thy Faithful. Just to mention a couple of things. I guess one thing, Kenny Wells' father passed away this week after a long illness. He was in his 90s, 90, can't remember.
91, I think.
91, and passed away. It's kind of bittersweet, right? And he was very ill and suffered a lot, so they're glad that over. And he knows Jesus, and so he's gone to be home with in heaven. And then, of course, the sadness of losing your dad that's been around for all your life. So we'll pray for them. Anyway, this morning we're going to sing, and then we'll continue our study in the book of Hebrews. So let's pray. Father, thank you for the opportunity we have to gather like this. We pray that you'll bless our time together, bless those that are here. Pray for those that aren't. We have some people not feeling well today. Think of Kim and bless her today and others. And we just pray, Lord, that you will bless our time together. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Old school with a song sheet, Great Is Thy Faithfulness, an old hymn.
But still relevant.
Still relevant, yes. Aren't you glad you know the Lord in these times?
Amen.
Yeah,
amen.
Really. It's pretty amazing. So, all right, we're ready?
Ask them to stand up.
Would you stand up?
Please.
Let's sing. See, it comes from what book in the Bible? Lamentations, which was not a time of great joy, right?
Right.
After the fall of Jerusalem. And so, want to continue our study today in Romans. We're going to go back and review a little bit from chapter 4 before moving to chapter 5. But I'm going to have, in just a moment, my lovely bride, the lovely Mrs. Clemenson, as I affectionately call her. She's going to come up and share her conversion story. She was telling me this a couple of weeks ago, and I'd heard it before, but it's just a fantastic, simple presentation of how you come to Jesus as a little eight-year-old girl in East Texas. And just brings back memories of my own heritage and background and all that. And I thought, what a better way to have someone share that than her. First, she adds class to the operation, and she does a good job. So, Bethy, come on up.
You could stay there.
No, I'd like to watch you.
Oh.
You're very good looking.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Oh, got a frog in my throat here. So, public speaking is so far out of my comfort zone. So I let Paul do that, and he does a great job. After 46 years of marriage, I still enjoy listening to him teach God's word. So, as you get older, some of your memories fade, but some are vivid. Some memories really are vivid in your mind. I was born and raised on the south side of Longview, Texas. I grew up one block from the massive church, Moberly Avenue Baptist Church. The sidewalks and parking lot were our playground growing up. And on a side note, also on the south side of town was Laterno College, now Laterno University. And Laterno is a Christian engineering and aviation, is that correct, school. And a lot of students are from northern states for whatever reason. And back then, and I don't know what the ratio is now, but it was like 7 boys to 1 girl. And some of the students came to the church that I grew up in, and I was always told, don't marry one of those Laterno boys, because they take our southern girls, take them off up north, and just, you know, keep them up there. Well, what did I do? I married a Laterno student. And he
is
from about as far north as you can get, Alaska. So, anyway, growing up, I was raised in a Christian home, went to Sunday school and church. One of my favorite things was vacation Bible school every summer. I had great Sunday school teachers, great vacation Bible school teachers, taught us the Word of God. And early on, I learned, memorized, probably the first verse I learned was John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And I, like a lot of people, grew up memorizing verses from the King James. Also began to hear about the Romans Road and salvation. And I would go...
Someone says they can't hear you.
Oh, okay. I can speak louder.
Okay.
Ask Paul. I yell at him.
He probably still doesn't listen.
Huh? Yes, I'll speak louder. But so I learned about salvation early on, and I would sit in church with my parents, and each Sunday they would give an altar call. And our pastor that time was Brother Barney Walker. And back then, I didn't call him pastor or preacher. It was Brother Walker. And he would give a clear salvation message and an invitation at the end of the service. And so one Sunday, I tugged on my parents, and I went up front, and it was a long walk, because it was a big church. It seemed like it was a long walk up that center aisle, and I told them that I wanted to be saved. So we went, and Brother Walker's office, and I remember so vividly sitting across the desk from him. It seemed like a desk, and he, you know, just very simply explained that salvation is a gift. And he said, you know, if I give you a gift, if I slide a gift across the desk to you, what do? And I said, well, you take it. And that's the simple message of salvation. It's a free gift. It's the gift that God provided for us through the death, burial, and resurrection of his son, Jesus Christ. And I was saved that day in Brother Walker's office. And I went on and followed the Lord in believer's baptism. And I remember that being very scary. But I did it, and I was 8 years old. And it's the best. I mean, the life, the Christian life is just a life of joy and peace. And it's really the only way. And, you know, I obviously have made mistakes. I've faltered. I've stumbled over the years. But I know that I have a secure place in heaven, and I'm so thankful for the promise of heaven. Thank you.
It's great, isn't it?
Yep.
Yeah.
That's really the message of salvation. And, you know, sometimes people like me, you go to seminary and you have all this theology, and really what's it all down to is here's a gift. Would you like a gift? And that's all it is. And so I, when she told that story again, reminded me of that a couple weeks ago. I said I wanted her to tell it. And she always says that she's not a good public speaker, but she's very good, very good. So I appreciate her and I love her, and she means everything to me. As we're moving through Romans, we're supposed to be in chapter 5 today, and I want to get to it because if you read my Facebook post, it's like a loaded baked potato of delicious stuff. And that is Romans 5. And we're going to look at that in a minute. But I just want to review and pick up where we left off last week, because I did not get through the second half of chapter 4. And as I was thinking about this week, Romans has been really been a blessing to me as I've studied it. And we went through it, as I've mentioned multiple times, the chapters 1 through 3, to a certain degree, it's kind of a dark section, right? Where he talks about judgment, he talks about sin, and I got to relating that or correlating that to a diagnosis of a life-threatening disease. How important is the diagnosis of that disease? It's vital, isn't it? Paul, you have cancer. That's pretty serious, or that diagnosis. You have to have that diagnosis in order to do what? Treat it, and hopefully get a cure. Well, the diagnosis for you and me, for everybody, all mankind, is we're all sinners, and we fall short of God's glory. The result of that is an eternity without God in a place called hell, which people don't like to talk about, but I would be lying to you if I didn't talk about it, because it's in... Jesus talked about it. It's in the book, right? The beauty of this, as unlike cancer or some other disease, the cure for sin is 100% effective. And that is the blood of Jesus Christ, just as Beth talked about. Him dying on the cross, being buried and rising again, paid the penalty of our sins so we can have a 100% cure for our sinful condition. Correct? And so for the first three chapters, Paul's been giving the diagnosis. It's not good. It's not good. But he's getting us to a point to realize, okay, people, you have a problem. Okay? Now that you have a problem, let me tell you what the cure is. And the cure is Jesus Christ and his death. And how do we access that cure? By faith. And he talked about that first three chapters. Chapter 4, which we started last week, and I'm going to get through it quickly because I do want to get to chapter 5 today. Chapter 4, he's dealing with Abraham as the example of how this righteousness, how this salvation process works. And how was Abraham saved? When was he saved? We're going to use the New Testament term. When was he saved? When he believed. And when did he first believe in God? When God said to him, come on class, I need your help. When God said to him, I want you to get out of the land of the Chaldeans and I want you to go to a land that I will show you, that was Genesis 12. And then he made the big, what we call the Abrahamic covenant. In chapter 17 is when he was actually circumcised. And of course, circumcision is huge to the Jews. That's a big part of their religion, right? And it's mandated by God. But he was saved long before he was circumcised. We talked about how Abraham was the bridge between the Gentiles and the Jews. In the early church, there were Jewish and Gentile believers. It was a big deal. It's not so much anymore. Time has passed. But in those days, it was very important. And what Paul is saying, there is no difference between Jew and Greek. We're all saved the same way. And Abraham was a perfect example of that. And his faith. And then we talked about it. And beginning in, we don't have our overhead with the passages today, but let me read this to you. I'll try to read it slowly enough so I don't stumble. Romans 4, continuing in verse 13, for the promise to Abraham and his offspring that he would be heir of the world did not come through law, but through the righteousness of faith. Didn't come through the law. Again, here's the thing. If I keep the law, I'm going to make it. If I don't, I'm not. The point of the law is it's perfect. We can't make it on our own. That's what he's saying. And so the promise that Abraham received did not come through the law or through doing good stuff. It came through simply faith. For if it is the adherents of the law whom are heirs, then faith is null and the promise is void. What is he saying there? He's saying that if you're going to make it by keeping the law, then there's no need for faith.
Right.
Right? And he says, then for the law brings wrath. Why does the law bring wrath?
Nobody can keep it.
You can't keep it. And God is a righteous God. You set the law. And by the way, most of us believe in the law, right? Mm-hmm. We want people who do horrible things to be punished. And that's our sense of right and wrong. It brings wrath. That is why, verse 16, that is why it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his offspring. What does it mean? Why is it important to be based on grace? Rest on grace. What is grace?
God's riches in Christ.
God's riches. It's God giving us something we don't deserve. That's grace, right? He used earlier, or maybe it's in this section, I can't remember. We'll go to work tomorrow, right? And then whenever your pay period ends, in a matter of time, you're going to get a what? A check. That's not grace. You earn every penny of that, right? And so what he's saying is that, but grace is not something that's guaranteed, or grace is not something we earn, rather. It's something that's given. It says, and then he expands it, verse 16, not only to the adherent of the law, but also to the one who shares the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. We're a part of the Abrahamic nations, correct? We're not Jewish, I don't think. Maybe there's a Jewish person there. But I'm not Jewish, right? But the promise to Abraham has come to me. Why? By faith. Yeah. And so, and then it says, in the presence of God in whom he believed, that's Abraham, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. In hope, he believed against hope that he should become the father of many nations, as he had been told, so shall your offspring be. Verse 19, he did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which is good as dead. In other words, he looked at himself. We reach a certain point, right, where we can't produce children anymore. Things don't work. Now, he went on to marry Keturah and had a whole bunch more, so he had more children. But the point is he looked at himself and he says, I'm an old man, I can't have children, but God said I would, so guess what? I believe. And he never lacked that. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. That was another miracle. Sarah had dried up. She was no longer going to be able to produce children, and yet God promised that she would. And then no unbelief made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, fully convinced that God was able to do what he has promised. I wish I was that way. Fully convinced that God keeps his promises. Do you ever sometimes doubt a little bit? Sometimes? Yeah. I ask God all the time, why don't you fix this? Somebody you care about that's wandered away or is not a part. Does God want to fix that person?
Yes.
I think so. Why doesn't he? God says, God is not, somebody wrote, God is not willing that any should perish. Did Paul write that? God is not willing that any should perish, but what?
All should
come to repentance. One of my favorite stories is when Paul's before Agrippa, and he reasons with Agrippa about his faith. And Agrippa says to him, do you think you can persuade me to be a Christian? And Paul wanted to, right? We have no record that Agrippa ever became a Christian. And so, does that shake your faith? It doesn't shake my faith. For some weird reason, it makes me stronger. Again, because of this book. Because you see these continual examples of the fact that we believe. And then it says, verse 20, he was fully convinced that God was able to do what he promised. That is why his faith was counted to him as righteousness. But the words that was counted to him were not written for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be counted to us who believe in him who raised Jesus, raised from the dead, Jesus our Lord, who was delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification. That word, from which that word, English word, counted, is really, in reality, kind of a banking term. And what he's saying there is that righteousness is credited to your account, right? And that's what happens. God's righteousness is given to us as if the bank gave us a credit into our account. And so it was counted to him as righteousness. This is the thing that is so foreign to us in our human thinking. When God looks at us, people who have been covered by the blood of Christ, what does he see? Pure and sinless people. Do you feel that way? Do we look at each other as sinless people? Absolutely not. Now, it's not like God is naive and doesn't know what's going on. But he looks at us and he doesn't condemn us because we trust in Christ. That is so contrary to human thinking, isn't it? But it's biblical. Now, we're going to talk about later, I think next week, can't remember where. Should we sin that grace may abound?
By no means.
The more you sin, the more grace. Should we sin more to get more grace? Absolutely not. It's just one of those amazing things because we don't judge each other that way, do we? You hurt me enough times or I hurt you enough times, what are you going to do? Going to walk away.
Build a wall.
Gonna build a wall. Going to withdraw. I don't think there's any way to get around that kind of pain, and you've experienced that. So, again, Abraham's example. Now, we got a little time to get into chapter 5. Chapter 5 is verses 1 through 6, and then next week, by the way, I handed out the message. Cheryl's already got credit for the title for next week.
Tale of Two Men,
Abraham and Adam. So there's a worksheet there with some questions, but... Adam and Jesus, what did I say?
Abraham and Adam.
Well, whatever. I messed up.
You meant the second Adam.
Yeah, he's the second Adam. Yeah, we'll talk about that next week or maybe the week after. We'll see. But here we have chapter. It's like, have you ever come out? Well, you have. If you've flown an airplane in the clouds, what happens? As you climb, you can't see, and then all of a sudden, sunshine. right? You get above the clouds. Romans 5, verses 1 through 11 is kind of like climbing out of the clouds and seeing all the bright sunshine of God's blessing. Because he says in chapter 5, verse 1, now remember, chapter 4, verse 25, it says, it counted to us who believe, verse 24, but for ours also, that's us here in this room and watching on Facebook, it will be counted to us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord, from the dead Jesus our Lord, who was delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification. Therefore, verse 1 of chapter 5, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So we see in verses 1 through 5 the results of our justification. By the way, this section is... did I put that there last week? I can't remember what I did. No, it's not yet. Never mind. I withdraw that. We are moving toward the end of the section in Romans where Paul has been dealing with the subject of justification. And justification is just as if I never sinned. Shortly we will be moving, after next week's message, we will be moving into a section on sanctification, beginning in chapter 6. What is sanctification? Being made set apart. Justification is that moment that Beth experienced in Brother...
Walker.
Johnny Walker? No.
Barney.
Barney Walker. And Brother Barney Walker's office that day, she experienced justification. Right? That was when we come to the point where we believe. Then we begin a life of walking with God, which we call sanctification, this process of being set apart. And so we'll talk about that next week. But anyway, he says, therefore we have been justified by faith. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. There are four results of justification mentioned here. First of all, we have peace with God. Have you ever had a conflict with somebody and it's been resolved? I mean really resolved. I don't mean, don't worry about it. And it's still there?
Yes.
A conflict that's really been resolved? What a feeling of relief that is, isn't it? Mm-hmm. When it's a mutual apology, look, I didn't mean to, I'm sorry, I forgive you. And there's such a fresh air when friendships and relationships are restored. They're very, very special. It's wonderful. Well, by faith, we have that conflict we have with God has been removed. We have peace with God. That's the first thing. Not only that, the second thing, through him, we have also access to grace. What is grace again? It's unmerited favor. We, as we've been talking about, mention it. You and I, it's almost impossible for us to exhibit anything but conditional love, right? I will love you, and I really will love you, until you hurt me so bad I can't love you anymore, or I have to move on. With God, it's unconditional. So for example, if you struggle with something in your life and you keep failing God, how do you think God looks at you when you continue to fail? He's going to reach some point where he's going to be irritated with you. But he doesn't. He continually forgives. That's the kind of love that God portrays to us. It's unconditional. And so we have access by faith into the grace in which we stand. So we have peace with God. We have access to grace, unlimited grace. I love that. The third thing is, we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. We rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. What does that mean? Let's take it apart. What do we mean by rejoice?
Celebrate,
yeah. Rejoicing and thanksgiving go together, I think. Don't they, those two things? And I heard something somewhere this week on the radio, I think it was, that people who are genuinely thankful live longer and healthier lives. And I thought, Why is that the case? I think it's true. I love my neighbor, Carl Lerick. I've mentioned him many times. We took him halibut yesterday. Beth fried up halibut. And he's 90-some years old, and he is an Ann, too. And they're just positive people. He says, some people's hair gets gray, mine got loose. he's an upbeat, positive guy, and he's lived in that area a long time. And Alan's mom knew him years ago. They've been neighbors for years and years. And so we rejoice. We who follow Jesus ought to always be upbeat and positive about life. We really do, no matter the circumstances. Now, I don't mean you don't get to a point in your life where you get down. We do, okay? I'm not some false thing. But we ought to see life through an eye of rejoicing. Paul wrote it in Philippians 4. You get down in the dumps, read Philippians 4. Rejoice, he says. And again, I say rejoice. So we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. We use hope in a couple of different ways, right? I may buy a lottery ticket this week, and I hope I win the Mega Millions. What are the chances of that happening?
Slim.
Very slim.
Slim to none.
Slim to none. And slim has left town. Is that what they say? But, so hope has that. You know, I hope. But then there's a hope that is sure, and that's the kind of hope that's in Scripture. It's a genuine, we're hoping in something that is a reality, and we place our hope. We hope in the glory of God. The glory of God. All have sinned and fallen short of what?
The glory of God.
The glory of God. What is the glory of God? What's he talking about?
His presence,
yeah.
His perfection,
yeah. If we fall short of the glory of God, now we have hope in the glory of God. What does that mean? We've made it, right? And how have we made it?
Through
faith in Jesus Christ. Not because I'm a good guy. I talked last week about a resume. If I bring my resume to St. Peter at the gate, I'm screwed. But if I bring him the covering of the blood of Christ, I have hope. So when we talk, and Beth talked about this a little bit ago, when we rejoice in heaven and hope in heaven, that's genuine, isn't it? So who do you think you are? I'm nobody. It's who Jesus is. That's why I have this hope. He punched the ticket. He gave me the gift. I took it, and I'm going to show him when I see him, figuratively, that I took the gift that he gave, and therefore I have hope. Am I afraid to die? Well, I'm not looking forward to the event, right? You know, if they said if you knew where you'd die, you'd never go in that area, right? You'd never go to that town if you knew where you were going to be when you were going to die. We all don't know how we're going to die. Hopefully you're not thinking about it, but we all know that unless Jesus comes back in our lifetime, we are one day going to reach a point where we'll no longer be alive. And those of us who follow Christ talk about the fact that we have this hope and the assurance of our faith. So we have peace with God, we have access to grace, we have hope in the glory of God, and then this last thing, which I find to be a little nuts, we rejoice in our sufferings. Seriously? We rejoice in our sufferings. I like to rejoice in the hope, right? But we also rejoice in our sufferings. Because, and here's this great list. What does suffering produce?
Endurance.
What is endurance?
Gonna make it.
So our suffering produces endurance. How does it produce endurance?
Gives us strength,
yeah. Some of the most dark, difficult times in my life, personally, and I know others will say this probably too, have been some of the best. my life looking back. Not because I enjoyed them, but because of what it produced. It produces endurance. And what does endurance produce? Character. What is character?
Doing the right thing when you're
doing it. Okay, doing the right thing. It's being real, right? It's being. One of the things I try to remember is that people don't expect for us to be perfect, but they want us to be genuinely real. And it produces character. And character produces what?
Hope.
And what does hope not do? Doesn't put us to shame.
You know, the NIV is, and hope does not disappoint.
Okay.
I love that version of it.
Okay. NIV, hope does not disappoint. Yeah. Where does that put that in here? In verse 5?
Yeah. Hope does not put us to shame. Hope does not disappoint.
Disappoint. Okay. It doesn't. Hope doesn't disappoint. And again, as I mentioned, I look back at tough times I've gone through that I would say weren't my fault. I've done enough that were my fault. And those are good too, but they're not quite as positive because you wouldn't have to go through those. But when you go through stuff, you look back at them and you see that this process that you've come through, and you look back and you go, okay, God, I understand why that happened. I don't always understand why it happened. I can see the value as to why it happened. And it does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given us. What does that mean? God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. So what has he just talked about? Suffering, producing endurance, producing character, producing hope, which doesn't disappoint, because God's love has been poured into us through the Holy Spirit. How does that process work? This is the beauty of language, because mm-hmm. You've got to say, what's he saying there?
Gives us a desire to live a thankful life.
Gives us a desire to live a thankful life, okay.
I think it gives us the ability to love people we wouldn't even normally like.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's it too.
I think that too.
What is the term love of God? How would you interpret love of God? Would it be our love for God or God's love for us?
It's God's love for us. Mm-hmm. But it's
could mean either one, though, couldn't it? There's a Greek language grammar thing that talks about, I can't remember, I studied it years ago, but you look at a word and said the love of God or God's love. The love of God could either mean our love for God or God's love for us. Both are legit, right?
Right.
Right. What is he saying here? I think he's saying the latter. God's love for us is poured into our hearts through difficult times. How does that happen? I think, Dave, what you said is right. It gives us sympathy for others who go through stuff. There's a peace in difficult times. Have you gone through difficult times and also experienced peace through that? Not lasting always, right? But little respites of peace where you realize, you know, God, you're in control of this, right? And it's just like Beth said in her testimony, the Christian life is more than just a piece of paper that says, when I die, I'm going to heaven. That is just the beginning of it. It's not an insurance policy. It's an abundant life. Jesus said, I've come to give them life and to give them more abundantly. What is abundant life? Be rich and healthy and never have any problems? No. In fact, you may never be rich. You may have all kinds of problems, and yet you'll have an abundant life because of the peace of God that fills us. It just fills us. And so we look out, that's what endurance is. You know, if you train for athletic competition, what happens when you first begin? You're sore, you're stiff, you can't move, and you're slow. What happens as you continue? You get stronger, right? You have more endurance, and you feel better. That's what endurance does. That's what the exercise is, being the suffering, producing endurance. And then the more you're able to endure, the more you can take things on. Remember when you were learning to tie your shoe? It was a big deal. Is it a big deal anymore to tie your shoe? No, because you know, you've experienced it. That's maybe a silly analogy, but I think that's what he's saying here. That again, this grows out of this whole concept of justification, of salvation. Right? It's growing out of that. And when we begin this sitting across the desk from Brother Walker, and he talks about the gift, that begins this journey. That's when we then begin access to have to peace with God. We have access to grace, rejoice in hope, and then that leads us to this process of our sufferings producing endurance. Endurance produces character. Character produces hope. And hope doesn't disappoint. I'm going to use that translation. I like it. Because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who's been given to us. God, through suffering, because of justification and this process of living life with suffering and all of the aspects of it, God then, through that, as we grow, pours his love into our heart. And we thrive in our walk with Christ. That's the Christianity I want people to experience. Not a bunch of rules and regulations and rituals and things we go through, empty rituals. I'm talking about a heartfelt, deep-felt, life-fulfilling fullness of God living in us. That's discipleship. And that's the life we live. I'm going to stop there. We'll come back to it next week. Any comments before? That was more than 2 minutes, like Peter.
At least three.
Any thoughts? We'll go back and do this again next week because I think it's vital, right? It's vital. Faith, our faith in Christ opens this unbelievably fantastic life that others may not see the circumstances of our life, they may not envy, but we ought to be able to exude peace and confidence in our walk, right? Not because we're special. Why? Because Brother Walker said, here's a gift. And little Bethy took it. And those of you in this room took it. And if you haven't taken it, the same thing is the same. The gift is available. Let us pray. Real loud in the back, Brother Chris, who's here for his 4-week visit with us, would you lead us in prayer?
Sure. Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your loving kindness. We thank you that you have allowed us to have faith in you. We pray that you just continue to build on that faith, Father, each and every day, and that we would go through the week just praising you and making the most of the opportunities that we have, Father. We thank you for this morning. We thank you for Paul. And we thank you for his love for your word and his truthfulness. And we pray that you just continue to give him wisdom and continue to bless him and use him mightily.
Amen. We're going to go to B-Dubs after church today. We'll see you all on Facebook next week.